The next item of business is a statement by Nicola Sturgeon on COVID-19 updates. The First Minister will take questions at the end of her statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. I call on Nicola Sturgeon, First Minister. Just bear with me a moment, First Minister. Thank you.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I will report today on the current and, at this stage, much more positive course of the pandemic. I will explain why, although significant pressures and uncertainties do remain, the latest data nevertheless gives us confidence that we have turned the corner on the Omicron wave. I will then confirm our next steps in lifting the protective measures introduced before Christmas. I will also indicate what we can all continue to do in the immediate period ahead to keep cases on a downward trend and reduce the pressure on the NHS and the wider economy. And finally, I will provide a further update on the vaccination programme. First, though, today's statistics show that 7,752 positive cases were reported yesterday through both PCR and lateral flow tests. 1,546 people are currently in hospital with COVID. That is 21 fewer than yesterday. 59 people are currently in intensive care, including 17 who have been in ICU for more than 28 days, and that's one more than yesterday. Sadly, though, a further 31 deaths have been reported, which takes the total number of deaths under the daily definition to 10,093. And once again, I send my condolences to everyone who is mourning a loved one. As we can see from the data, Omicron is continuing to infect large numbers of people here in Scotland, across the UK and indeed in many other countries around the world. Hospital admissions and overall hospital occupancy associated with COVID also remain high. However, notwithstanding the very real challenges COVID continues to present, the evidence I set out last week suggesting that the situation was beginning to improve has significantly strengthened over the past 7 days. A combination of booster vaccinations, the willingness of the public to adapt their behaviour to help stem transmission, and the temporary protective measures introduced in December has helped blunt the impact of the Omicron wave. Last week I said that the data indicated cases were falling across most age groups, and I can report today that this trend has continued. Now, there still needs to be some caution applied in interpreting case data at this stage, given the recent changes to guidance on PCR and lateral flow testing. However, data for the past 13 days, taking account of both PCR and lateral flow tests, shows a significant fall in the number of new positive cases. And to put some detail on that, on Sunday, Monday and Tuesday of last week, 36,526 new positive cases were recorded through PCR and lateral flow tests. This week, over Sunday, Monday and today, Tuesday, 20,268 cases have been reported, so quite a significant drop. And if we look just at PCR tests, although I would ask everybody to bear in mind the limitations now in doing so, we have seen cases fall from an average of almost 13,000 a day to just over 4,600. That's a decline of 64%, and cases have fallen across all age groups. Test positivity in PCR tests has also declined from almost 30% in early January to under 20% now. The most recent Office of National Statistics data, which covers the week to the 7th of January, and so it does have a time lag associated with it, reinforces this more stable and positive assessment. It indicated that the number of people with COVID in that week, around 1 in 20, was broadly the same as in the previous week. So taking all of this into account and triangulating the various sources of data allows us to say with some confidence that the rise in cases driven by Omicron peaked in the first week of January and that we are now on the downward slope of this wave of cases. This assessment is also reflected in the data on hospital admissions. Hospital occupancy, the number of patients in hospital at any given time with COVID, is higher than it was 7 days ago, increasing from 1,479 to 1,546 today. However, the increase of 67 is significantly smaller than it was in the previous 7 days. And encouragingly, admissions to hospital of people with COVID, though still too high, are nevertheless now actually falling. In the week to 7th January, 1,040 were admitted. In the week to 14th January, that was down to 960. The number of people in ICU, which this time last week was rising, has also now fallen slightly over the past 7 days, from 65 to 59. So all of this is very positive news, and it comes as an enormous relief, I am sure, to all of us. Of course, we do need to recognise that there are still some uncertainties ahead, and so throwing all caution to the wind at this stage would be a mistake. For example, the full impact of the return to work and school after the festive break won't be apparent yet in the data. So it is possible that we will see case numbers tick up again in the next couple of weeks. Also, just as the introduction of some protective measures may have helped slow down transmission, it stands to reason that the lifting of these measures could have the opposite effect. Indeed, that is exactly why it makes sense to lift measures on a phased basis. And lastly, although cases are now falling, the NHS remains under acute pressure and staff absences are still causing some disruption across the economy and our critical services. So while we can take great heart from the latest data, we know from experience how important it is to be responsible and appropriately cautious in the face of this virus. And that is the context then for the decisions that Cabinet reached this morning. Yesterday, of course, the limit on attendances at outdoor public events was lifted. The remaining statutory measures introduced in response to Omicron are as follows. Limits on attendance at indoor public events, the requirement for 1 metre physical distancing between different groups in indoor public places, the requirement for table service in hospitality premises, serving alcohol on the premises, and the closure of nightclubs. Given the improving situation, and as I said last week, we hoped to be able to do, I can confirm today that all of these measures will be lifted from next Monday, 24th January. We will also, from Monday, remove the guidance advising adults against non-professional indoor contact sports so that these can resume as normal. And from Monday, we will also lift the guidance asking people to stick to a three-household limit on indoor gatherings. However, it is important, I think, to stress this point. Notwithstanding the improving situation, the level of COVID infection circulating in the community is still high. So to minimise the risk of getting the virus, it would be sensible for all of us to remain cautious in our social interactions at this stage. Even though from Monday we will no longer recommend a fixed upper limit on numbers of households, if we all continue to keep gatherings as small as our circumstances allow for now, I would suggest until the end of this month, we will reduce our chances of getting infected. And of course, we should continue to take lateral flow tests before meeting up with people from other households. Please also remember to record test results, whether positive or negative, through the UK Government website. Let me stress this is even more important now that we are no longer advising confirmatory PCR tests for those without symptoms who test positive through lateral flow devices. Recording these results ensures that we are able to make better assessments of the trends in infection. Finally, Presiding Officer, we will continue to ask people to work from home whenever possible at this stage and for employers to facilitate this. However, we will engage with business now about a return to a more hybrid approach from the start of February. The baseline mitigation measures that were in place before Omicron and the requirement for businesses, service providers and places of worship to take reasonable measures to minimise the spread of COVID on their premises will be retained at this stage to help keep COVID contained as this wave recedes. That means face coverings must still be worn in public indoor settings and on public transport. Businesses and other organisations should continue to have regard to guidance and take reasonable steps to minimise the spread of COVID. And hospitality premises should continue to collect contact details for customers, which is, of course, important for the effective operation of Test and Protect. In addition, the COVID certification scheme will continue to apply for now to large indoor and outdoor events and to late night venues, all settings where transmission risks can be higher. As of yesterday, guidance stipulates that organisers of events with 1,000 or more in attendance should check the certification status of at least 50% of attendees or 1,000 people, whichever is higher. Now, I indicated last week that Cabinet would consider and decide today whether or not to extend the certification scheme to other premises, such as licensed hospitality venues. This was undoubtedly the most difficult decision we faced this morning, and yet again, the judgment we have arrived at was finely balanced. On the one hand, extending COVID certification could offer public health benefits, ensuring that people attending certain venues are vaccinated or tested. It reduces to some extent the risks of transmission and also the risk of serious illness should an individual contract the virus in one of these settings. On the other hand, we understand that extending certification could create additional costs for businesses at an already very challenging time. And of course, the smaller the business, the more difficult these costs can be to bear. So the task for Cabinet today was to weigh these considerations and decide what, in the current circumstances, would be proportionate. Given that cases are now falling quite rapidly and the current wave is receding, we decided that we will not, at this stage, extend the COVID certification scheme to other premises. We will, of course, reconsider this should circumstances and therefore the balance of judgment change in any significant way. If cases were to start to rise very sharply again, extension of certification may well be a more proportionate alternative to other more restrictive measures. However, our conclusion today, given the improving situation, is that extending certification would not be proportionate at this stage. There is, though, one reasonably minor change to the certification regulations that we will propose. At the moment, nightclubs and other late-night venues must apply the scheme if they have in use a designated area for dancing. We intend to amend the definition here to provide greater clarity and prevent premises from avoiding certification simply by having tables on a dance floor and therefore claiming it's not a dance floor but nevertheless permitting dancing to take place. This change will take effect from Monday when late night venues are able to reopen. Finally, Presiding Officer, let me say a few words about the updated rules on self-isolation after a positive COVID test. These rules, confirmed 2 weeks ago, remain in place. If you test positive, you will be advised to self-isolate for 10 days. However, if you don't have a fever and you take 2 negative lateral flow tests more than 24 hours apart on day 6 and day 7, you can end self-isolation on day 7. Last week, the UK Government announced further changes to self-isolation for England. This was publicised as allowing people to end self-isolation after day 5. Essentially, however, this change simply brings England's rules into line with those already in force in Scotland. This is because in Scotland, we count the day of a positive test as day 1 of isolation. In England, this is counted as day 0. In addition, in England, you can end self-isolation after day 5. In Scotland, you can end it on day 7. So the slightly different ways of defining the beginning and the end of the self-isolation period has given the impression of difference. But the substance, the period people are actually required to self-isolate for, is in fact the same in Scotland and in England. And I think it's important that people are clear about that. Presiding Officer, the lifting from Monday of the protections introduced in response to Omicron is possible in part because of the efforts everyone has made voluntarily and as a result of guidance and statutory measures to help stem transmission. And I want to put on record again today my thanks to people across the country. But it is also, of course, down to the success of vaccines. At this stage of the vaccination programme, we continue to offer boosters and also to implement the latest advice from the JCVI. Just before Christmas, the JCVI recommended that booster jabs should be offered to 16 and 17-year-olds 12 weeks after their second jabs. So any 16 or 17-year-old who had a second jab 12 weeks or more ago or who is just approaching that point can now book a booster appointment online through NHS Inform. They can also turn up at a drop-in centre and get a booster there. In addition, second doses of the vaccine are now available for 12 to 15-year-olds who had a first dose at least 12 weeks previously. Again, appointments can be booked online. Alternatively, young people can choose to go to a drop-in centre and parents and carers are, of course, welcome to attend with them. So far, the JCVI has recommended that booster jabs should be offered only to those 12 to 15-year-olds at particular clinical risk from COVID. Any 12 to 15-year-old in that position will receive a letter inviting them for a booster 12 weeks after their last primary dose. There is no need to book an appointment. And finally, 5 to 11-year-olds with specific medical conditions that put them at greater risk from COVID will be invited for their first vaccination from this week onwards. Again, let me stress, they will be contacted directly. There is no need for them, or more appropriately, their parents or carers to book online. In due course, 5 to 11-year-olds who are household contacts of people with immune suppression will also be invited to receive vaccination. And of course, we stand ready to quickly implement any updated advice from the JCVI about vaccinating all 5 to 11-year-olds. There are good reasons why the JCVI has given different advice for different age groups, but I realise it can be confusing. So the NHS Inform website now has a self-help guide for parents, carers and children, setting out what young people need to do to get vaccinated and when they can do it. If you can't get online, you can also get this information by phoning the vaccination hotline on 0800 030 8013. That's 0800 030 8013. Now, the final point I want to make relates to vaccinations for adults. Scotland has achieved very high rates of vaccination. We are the most vaccinated part of the UK in terms of first, second, third and booster doses. But there are still more than 600,000 people over the age of 18 who are eligible for a booster but haven't yet had it. And there are hundreds of thousands more who have not yet had a first or second dose. So I would encourage anyone who falls into one of these categories to make an appointment as soon as possible or go to a drop-in clinic. There is plenty of capacity and you will be made welcome. The latest available data adjusted for age shows that someone not fully vaccinated is at least 4 times more likely to require hospital treatment than someone who has had a booster or third dose. And although being fully vaccinated doesn't eradicate the risk for any of us of getting COVID, it does reduce that risk, and therefore it also reduces the risk of us passing it on to others. If you choose, therefore, without good reason, not to be fully vaccinated, you are putting your own and others' lives at unnecessary risk. So if you haven't had a booster or third jab yet, please come forward as soon as possible. And if you haven't had a first or second dose yet, please do so without delay. It is never too late to get the COVID vaccines and to start getting the protection that these vaccines do offer. Presiding Officer, the situation we face today is undoubtedly less severe and much more positive than it might otherwise have been without the sacrifices everyone has made over these past few weeks. Despite what people may be hearing from media commentary, though, we have not yet moved from the epidemic to the endemic phase of COVID, although I do hope that transition is underway. However, we are, I hope, once again entering a much calmer phase of the epidemic. That then allows us to consider the adaptations we might need to make to build our resilience and manage this virus in a less restrictive way in future as we do move into an endemic phase. We have, as I've indicated in previous weeks, started work now on an updated strategic framework, and we will be consulting on this over coming weeks. All of this, therefore, gives us much cause for renewed optimism. That said, we are still in a challenging position. The NHS does remain under very significant pressure. Indeed, as is reflected in today's A&E waiting time figures, the past couple of weeks have probably been the most difficult the NHS has ever faced, as COVID-related staff absences have compounded the other pressures it is dealing with. The number of COVID cases across Scotland, although declining, also remain high. And because Omicron is so infectious, there is still a significant risk attached to social meetings and interactions. That is why, although we can be increasingly optimistic at this stage, we must all still play our part in helping further slow the spread of the virus. So I close by highlighting again the steps we can all take to help do that. Firstly, as I've just talked about at length, please do get fully vaccinated if you haven't already. Second, take care when socialising. Until Monday, keep indoor gatherings to a maximum of 3 households. And after that, I suggest for the rest of this month, try to keep them as small as your circumstances allow. And test before you go every time. And lastly, please take all the other precautions that we know make a difference. Keep windows open if meeting indoors. Continue to work from home for now if you can. Wear a face covering on public transport, in shops and when moving about in hospitality, and follow all advice on hygiene. These measures do make a difference. The fact that so many people have stuck with them has helped make it possible to lift the protective measures put in place before Christmas. So if we continue to stick with them, we can all continue to do our bit to keep each other safe, protect the NHS, and keep us firmly on the path, even if only metaphorically speaking, to a much sunnier spring and summer.
Thank you. The First Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 40 minutes for questions, after which we'll move on to the next item of business. And I'd be grateful if members who wish to ask a question were to press the request to speak buttons now or enter R in the chat function. And I call Sandesh Gulhani.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And let me begin by urging everyone to keep getting vaccinated. Even if you have so far been against the vaccine, there is still time to change your mind and get your first jab. The First Minister's statement begins a sea change in the government's policy, starting to shift from a rules-based approach more towards trusting the Scottish public, as we were pushing for. Yesterday, we called for an end to all business restrictions, an end to guidance on household mixing and social distancing, and an end to the ban on indoor sports. We did so because the data shows that we are past the peak of Omicron. At this stage, protecting mental health, physical health, and Scottish jobs is every bit as important as slowing the spread of COVID. Most of what we've called for has been met, but the government still hasn't gone far enough in two key areas. Firstly, we welcome the move away from guidance on working from home, but can the First Minister explain the evidence behind that decision? Why at this stage can we not go further, perhaps publish all the evidence used to make this decision? And secondly, it's right that the First Minister has backed down on extending the vaccine passport scheme. For many Scottish businesses, it remains a burden and a potential risk. Yeah. The First Minister has twice threatened to extend the scheme to Scottish businesses. Twice she's backed down. Isn't it about time the First Minister accepted that this scheme is a dud and scrapped it altogether? Finally, while we are past the peak of the Omicron crisis, we are at the peak of the crisis in A&E departments. The latest appalling A&E figures show the worst ever waiting times for patients. Double the number of patients were waiting more than the target time compared to the same week last year. My colleagues on the front line of the NHS are overwhelmed. COVID is making things worse. But the root of the problem is not Omicron. It's the lack of a credible plan from Humza Yousaf. Yeah. How many wake-up calls does the Health Secretary need before he finally devises a coherent strategy to tackle the unacceptable emergency waiting times in Scotland?
First Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The government policy and approaches to tackling COVID has throughout these past 2 years and will continue to adapt in line with changes in the path of the virus. Keeping the public as safe as possible will continue to be a driving imperative. The approach that we are taking, have taken, is balanced, it is appropriately and suitably cautious, and it is data-driven. And for all of these reasons, it stands in stark contrast to the approach that the Conservatives have proposed at each and every stage. And I would gently remind the Chamber and indeed the public again today that at every turn, whenever decisions have been taken, the Conservatives have, in my view, rather opportunistically opposed whatever it has been that the Scottish Government had recommended. That's been the case on face coverings, it has been the case on working from home, it has been the case in terms of mitigations in our schools. So with the greatest of respect, when the Conservatives have called it wrong at every key juncture in the tackling of this virus, forgive me if I continue to follow clinical advice and take careful judgments rather than follow the advice that the member is offering today. On the two specific issues, firstly on working from home, I continue to be really surprised that Dr. Gulhani asks me for evidence of things that I think even non-clinically qualified people now see as pretty obvious. When you're coming out of a wave of this virus, The worst thing to do is to lift all restrictions at exactly the same time and allow all of the mixing and interactions that we have been trying to restrict to happen again all at once. And therefore, what is the evidence of saying that if people are not working from home, not travelling to get to work, not coming together in canteens, for example, at lunchtime, is because when we reduce that kind of interaction, we reduce the opportunities for the virus to spread. And while we are lifting other restrictions for a couple of weeks longer, it is prudent to keep that piece of guidance in place. So it's common sense, I would argue, and I think most people across the country understand that. Secondly, on accident and emergency, in passing, going back to my earlier point, I would simply say, had we followed the advice, if I can give it that polite term, of the Conservatives and lifted measures prematurely at previous stages, not had in place the mitigations that we have in place, we'd be in a much worse position with COVID than we are right now, and the pressure on our National Health Service and accident and emergency departments would be even greater than it is right now. We continue to support our National Health Service. The figures for A&E today reflect probably the most difficult period in the history of the National Health Service over the past couple of weeks, when staff absences have compounded the other pressures. I would hope we'll see these figures start to improve in the weeks ahead. We'll continue to support the National Health Service in every way we can, but the biggest thing, the most important thing all of us can do to support the National Health Service right now is continue to act in the careful way we have been doing to keep cases on that downward trajectory.
I call Anna Sarwar.
Can I start by sending my condolences to all those who have lost a loved one throughout this pandemic? Today's announcements offer hope to a lot of people who can once again look forward to getting some more normality back in their lives. But too many businesses are still teetering on the brink, and too many workers have found themselves waiting for weeks with no support. Just one example from my home city, where the First Minister needs to go further now. More than 100 staff working at two Glasgow theatres have been left without pay for an entire month. That is just one example from one sector that tells a story about the lack of urgency from this government. The scheme which would support these workers won't even publish its guidelines until tomorrow, and applications won't open for another week, never mind dispersal of the actual money. These workers have bills to pay and families to feed now. So what will the First Minister do today to support these workers and all like them across the whole of Scotland? 2 years into this pandemic, we should have already have a system which is built in resilience. And we all hope the worst is behind us. But going forward, any changes in these restrictions cannot be ad hoc. We need a system that sets clear trigger points on what people can expect when cases do rise, and lays out what financial support will be made available to people, when they'll be entitled to it, and when they will receive it. When can we expect meaningful debate on detailed proposals for a framework like this to come to this Parliament? Because restrictions, while well-intentioned, have had a detrimental impact on people's mental health and well-being, and we cannot expect people to live their lives like that indefinitely.
First Minister.
Firstly, on business support, the money that's been made available, I would remind people that much of the money made available in Scotland is not available in other parts of the UK. It's flowing where appropriate from local authorities, and in the case of theatres and those in the culture sector, from Creative Scotland. Creative Scotland has already started paying, for example, successful applicants into the Freelancers Hardship Fund, and other funds will be following right now. As I said last week, we are working with local authorities, with other agencies, to get this money out the door and into the bank accounts of those who need it as quickly as possible. There are checks and processes that have to be applied to guard against fraud. I noted yesterday the Chancellor of the Exchequer saying that £4.3 billion was being written off in money that had been fraudulently claimed earlier in the pandemic. I can imagine Anna Sarwar's reaction if we were in a position of taking decisions without appropriate checks here. So work continues to get that money out to people as quickly as possible, because we understand how badly needed it is. On the second point around the framework, I've already said we have started work on the framework. We will consult with parties across the chamber, with businesses and others across society in the coming weeks. We will bring that to Parliament over the next few weeks for debate and for a vote. It's really important, though, to understand the uncertainties that still exist. I understand the clamour for certainty. We all want certainty, but we are dealing with an unpredictable virus. Fixed trigger points would not serve anybody well at the moment, because we need to continue to apply judgment. To use the example of Omicron, a new variant, but as we quickly found out with Omicron, it didn't behave in exactly the same way as Delta behaves. So trigger points designed for Delta or now designed for Omicron may not be appropriate for the variant that comes along next. So we have to retain a degree of flexibility. And frankly, anybody who suggests otherwise is not going to, I think, navigate a path through this virus that serves the country well. Much of what we've done has been in line with other countries across the world. I think we've had far fewer restrictions in the latter phase of this pandemic than some other countries have had. No country has the magic answers to this, but as we learn more, we can have more certainty about the path we take. But that degree of flexibility, and I would say this very, very forcibly based on all of my experience of the last 2 years, is really important to retain.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And it is gratifying to hear that the Scottish Government have determined that it would be disproportionate to roll out the further use of vaccine certification at this stage. The Liberal Democrats have always said that COVID ID cards are disproportionate, full stop, and I hope they will now fall away. Presiding Officer, the announcements today will represent light at the tunnel for many, many people, not least in the hospitality sector, which was hobbled by the restrictions over Christmas, and many of whom are still looking for answers. Answers really matter, and people need to trust that if further restrictions are required in the future, that they will be based in transparency and in a science that they can see. Which makes it concerning then, Presiding Officer, that the Information Commissioner ruled last week that the government had acted unlawfully in withholding projections about a second wave. So can I ask the Scottish Government, in the light of the rebuke by the Information Commissioner, if it will commit to moving forward with transparency going forward?
First Minister.
Firstly, on the issue of COVID certification, I think the difference between me and the Scottish Government and Alex Cole-Hamilton is that we assess the proportionality on the basis of the evidence, and we make balanced judgments. If the evidence shows us that COVID certification is a less restrictive option than other measures, then we will consider that. Alex Cole-Hamilton takes a fixed ideological position, which I think in the face of an infectious virus is not appropriate, and that perhaps is the key difference. In terms of restrictions, none of us want to go back to restrictions. Even over these past few weeks when we've had further protective measures in place, they have been far less restrictive than at earlier stages in the pandemic, as we have been now for most of this year, actually gradually learning to live with COVID in a greater and greater way. But we need to continue to assess these things based on the evidence. The government has been totally transparent. We publish figures every single day. That's the data. People say show us the data. We publish the data every day. The evidence is how the virus behaves, and we know from epidemiological evidence that the virus spreads when people come together. It spreads more when people come together in particular settings. And we will continue to enhance that data as our knowledge becomes more developed. In terms of the freedom of information issue, the Commissioner actually found that the information withheld was of a type to which the exemption, which covered development of government policy, was applicable, accepted that this information was intended to assist in developing policy in relation to a possible second wave, but took a different view in assessing the public interest issue. And we will consider the Commissioner's decision now carefully and respond appropriately.
Thank you. I call Ruth Maguire, and I would take this opportunity on behalf of the Parliament to welcome Ms. Maguire back.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I was hoping to slip in quietly, but thank you anyway. On Saturday, NHS Ayrshire and Arran held a drop-in vaccination clinic for pregnant women and women who had recently delivered their baby at Ayrshire Maternity Unit, a very welcome initiative. It's crucial that women looking to conceive, including those accessing specialist IVF treatment, are also provided with timely information and advice on vaccination and how this might impact their hopes of conceiving. An example of where this didn't happen was raised with me recently. Those involved were left devastated. What action is the Scottish Government taking to ensure that women looking to conceive and those providing their healthcare are kept properly informed about the importance of vaccinations?
First Minister.
Thank you, President Officer. Can I also say how brilliant it is to have Ruth Maguire back with us as a friend, a colleague, indeed the MSP for my hometown. It's absolutely brilliant to see her looking so well and back here in Parliament. COVID, and she raises a really important issue. COVID continues, and I think it's important to stress this, to pose a serious risk to unvaccinated pregnant women and their babies. Data from Public Health Scotland shows that 98% of pregnant women with COVID who required intensive care in Scotland were unvaccinated. A decision was therefore taken by ministers to temporarily defer fertility treatment for women who are not fully vaccinated. I understand, fully understand, that undergoing fertility treatment is an emotional experience for those involved. Treatment centres are providing counselling to those women who want to discuss vaccination in more detail and are in touch with patients to provide further information on treatment and vaccination. Public Health Scotland has also produced information leaflets and online information encouraging vaccine uptake amongst pregnant women, and additional guidance on fertility and vaccination can be found on our Parent Club and NHS Inform websites.
Miles Briggs, to be followed by Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Throughout the pandemic, I've raised hospital parking for NHS staff with the First Minister, and I welcome some of the steps which the Government have taken. But from the start of this week, NHS staff here in Edinburgh are having their parking rights removed at Edinburgh Royal Infirmary. Over 20,000 people have signed a petition calling for a rethink. So can I ask the First Minister specifically, does she agree with me that frontline NHS staff working night shifts should always be given the option of a parking space? And secondly, will she today agree to a national review of hospital parking for NHS staff?
First Minister.
I agree that NHS staff should not have to pay to park their cars when they turn up to work. I was the Health Secretary that removed car parking charges at NHS-owned car parks. At the start of the pandemic, of course, Jean Freeman, when she was Health Secretary, managed to secure the removal of car parking charges from the PFI car parks that still had them. So it's an important principle. I'll ask the Health Secretary to engage with the Health Board about the particular issue so that we can ensure, particularly at this exceptionally challenging time for those who work in the front line of our NHS, that they are not being penalised unfairly.
Julian Martin, to be followed by Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As we all know, the challenges of the pandemic and more recently the Omicron variant have placed increased pressures on social care settings. And the Health and Social Care Partnership in Aberdeen are having to take staff away from other services and redeploy them to ease that pressure. What impact does the First Minister anticipate the funding of SSC registration and PVG checks will have on staffing levels in the sector? And is there anything more that we can do to help the social care frontline?
First Minister.
Well, the introduction of Scottish Government funding for SSC registration fees and PVG checks aims to assist easing winter pressures across this sector by removing any financial barriers that might stop people from applying for a career in care. So it is all about supporting those who work in the sector. Health and social care partnerships continue to face significant challenges in providing social care due to increased levels of demand and also staff absences. So we will continue to look at all options to further support the workforce. Indeed, later today, the Deputy First Minister, along with the Cabinet Secretaries for Health and Social Justice, are meeting with council leaders, local authority chief executives, COSLA, NHS boards and the third sector to discuss the need for a whole system response to prioritise social care and agree what more can be done both nationally and locally.
Monica Lennon, to be followed by John Mason.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. People living in care homes where self-isolation is 14 days and can last longer were not mentioned in the statement today. And many of them fear that they are being forgotten as the rest of us move on. Some families from Care Home Relatives Scotland describe their loved ones as having no visitors, no freedom, and worst of all, no hope. Will the First Minister listen to their concerns? Will she reassess the proportionality of the 14-day isolation rules? And will we await for the government to give effect to Anne's law? Will she ensure that full use is being made of PPE testing and vaccines to facilitate safe visiting and contact between care home residents and their loved ones?
First Minister.
Well, firstly, care homes should be ensuring appropriate visiting for residents and making full use of PPE and testing, and I know care homes are working hard to do that. Looking specifically at the issue of self-isolation, let me say here, our overriding priority throughout the pandemic indeed, although decisions, of course, understandably have been subject to question and criticism, but our overriding priority has been to safeguard and protect residents and staff in care homes, and at times during this pandemic these have been some of the most difficult decisions with some of the most challenging and difficult outcomes. But it remains really important that we take very, very careful decisions here, given the frailty and the vulnerability of the people that we are discussing. The measures that are currently in place do ensure that loved ones can have contact with residents while balancing the COVID risk and the need to keep people safe in line with clinical and public health advice. And this is especially true, I think, given the emergence of Omicron, which is so much more infectious. However, as I think I said in the Chamber last week, given the recent changes to isolation more generally that we announced 2 weeks ago, we had already commissioned public health experts to review the guidelines currently in place for care home residents, and we expect to be able to announce an updated position on that imminently. But I hope Monica Lennon and indeed the whole Chamber will accept that it is important we do so on the basis of quality clinical and expert advice.
John Mason, to be followed by Gillian Mackay.
Thank you. My understanding is that the latest round of business grants for hospitality and similar businesses has gone to those that got it in the previous rounds. However, for some businesses, either they're new or their circumstances have changed and they missed the first round for a technicality. Is it possible for such businesses to get a grant in this latest round?
First Minister.
Yes, it is. New hospitality businesses that didn't previously receive funding can complete an application form. That means local authorities can then assess their eligibility and they will be contacted by local authorities within 14 days of receiving an application. The application form is live on the Scottish Government website. The reason for automatically going to those who previously got support is for speed of getting money to people, but we do not want to exclude anybody who didn't get support previously if they are entitled to it now.
Gillian Mackay, to be followed by Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased that we're seeing a downturn in cases, but as we know, things can change rapidly, so it's essential that caution is maintained. I'm relieved that we're not following the reckless advice of those who suggested scrapping self-isolation for those who test positive. We need to ensure public compliance with measures, and that means supporting those who need to isolate. Will the First Minister confirm that the Scottish Government will continue to make support available for those who need to isolate?
First Minister.
Yes, I can confirm that, and I think it's a really important point to raise. Isolation remains a really important part of our response to this virus to help us break the chains of transmission, and that is obviously particularly the case when someone has tested positive. One of the unanswered questions in what the Conservatives were calling on us to do yesterday, which was just to, as I read it, remove everything and take our chances with COVID, is whether they were actually suggesting that we should remove self-isolation for those who had tested positive. And perhaps that is something that they'll take the opportunity to clarify. But we will keep in place support for those who are self-isolating, because we recognise the financial challenges. None of this is easy. None of this is what any of us want to be in the position of doing. But particularly at this stage, almost 2 years in, it's really important that we take basic precautions in order to avoid, as far as we can, the situation going into reverse again.
Claire Adamson, to be followed by Russell Finlay.
Officer, First Minister, the vaccination certification programme has been pivotal in allowing people to take part in activities in Scotland during COVID restrictions, but also for those travelling abroad for work or for pleasure in order to meet the requirements of the country they are visiting. Can the First Minister give any advice to those relying on a paper copy of the vaccine certificate to ensure that they can prove their booster status and access an up-to-date QR code?
First Minister.
But paper certificates are available. I set that out again last week, and they are accepted at domestic venues where the certification scheme is in operation, and also accepted by most countries around the world for entry through borders. Boosters were added to paper certificates on the 13th of December, so people should request a new copy if their certificate was issued before that date. In addition, QR codes are regularly updated for security reasons, and paper copies should be renewed every 3 months to ensure that a valid QR code is used. Where possible, we do encourage people to use the app for domestic purposes and indeed for international travel certification requirements, because this updates all QR codes each time the app is activated. But paper copies do continue to be available.
Russell Finlay, to be followed by Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you. Today, the Scottish Court Service published new data about tens of thousands of pending criminal trials, many delayed by COVID. The most recent figures from December show 760 of these are in the High Court. In every single one, there's a victim or a murder victim's family waiting for justice. Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government rejected my party's call for additional funding to clear this backlog. So what would the First Minister say to those victims and their families?
First Minister.
We are, of course, making funding available to the Courts Service to help with backlog. Also, we have ensured in the budget, the draft budget that was published just a matter of weeks ago, that the justice system more generally, including the court system and indeed the Crown Office, are getting a fair settlement in light of the circumstances we face. I deeply regret the impact of this virus on everybody who has suffered because of it. Many, many people have suffered health impacts because they've had the virus, become seriously unwell. Sadly, too many people across our country are bereaved as a result of this virus. But even for those of us who haven't had the virus or who haven't lost a family member, there have been a plethora of other impacts, and that undoubtedly includes victims of crime having trials delayed. I wish none of this had happened. I wish we weren't in and never had been in this global pandemic. But we are, and we need to continue to manage the impacts of this, getting COVID under control, keeping it under control, moving into a phase where we can manage it much less restrictively is a key part of that. And then supporting and funding organisations to catch up on the backlog is work that we will continue to have our focus for this year and no doubt in some respects beyond that. And we continue to give all of that our utmost priority as we move forward.
Audrey Nicholl, to be followed by Daniel Johnson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what further help the Scottish Government can offer vaccine trial participants so that they're not disadvantaged by recent changes to rules on self-isolation and international travel, in particular the requirement for a booster, something that many trial participants do not yet qualify for.
First Minister.
Well, it's an important question for those who did take part in trials. Let me stress, clinical trial participants are treated the same as the rest of the population and therefore eligible for boosters and offered them in line with the normal eligibility criteria for the booster programme. For domestic and international travel, self-isolation on return to Scotland, clinical trial participants are treated as if they are fully vaccinated and therefore should follow the guidance on testing and self-isolation detailed on gov.scot. For travel to other countries, all travellers should follow the relevant individual guidance and entry conditions required. And further information on other countries' entry requirements is available at gov.uk.
Daniel Johnson, to be followed by Paul McLennan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. On the 5th of January, the First Minister confirmed that £375 million would be made available for business support. To date, I believe that only £262 million has been allocated, leaving £113 million. If correct, when will this sum be allocated? And will it afford the government the ability to address the issues outlined by Mr Mason, but also to extend support to sectors which so far have completely missed out, such as retail, given the deeply damaging impact restrictions have had on this most critical trading time of the year? And I remind the Chamber of my register of interests.
First Minister.
We continue to liaise with individual sectors to try to make sure that any remaining funds that we have to allocate are targeted as effectively as possible. We started allocating funds to those most obviously impacted, but there are a variety of other impacts that we want to make sure we properly understand and as far as resources allow us to address and respond to. So further announcements will be made in due course and as quickly as possible. We'll also publish, as we did in previous stages of the pandemic, outturn data on the actual disbursement of monies, and that will be published at or towards the end of January. So we'll do everything within our power to make sure that all businesses across different sectors that have been impacted by this most latest phase get some help and as much help as we're able to provide.
Paul McLennan, to be followed by Alexander Burnett.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. People throughout Scotland have been disgusted by the hypocritical behaviour of the Prime Minister, who has flouted the rules of his own government on numerous occasions and yet continues in his role. What would the First Minister say to those people who feel that this situation undermines the credibility of the public health message?
First Minister.
Well, I think I've made my views clear, as many other people have, about the reports of repeated and serial breaches of the COVID rules on the part of the Prime Minister or those working for and around the Prime Minister. I absolutely understand the intense anger that people feel about this, given the very painful sacrifices that so many people have made over the past couple of years. Of course, all of that has the potential to undermine compliance with the things that we are still asking people to do. But what I would say to people is this: the reason for complying with any guidance or protective measures in place at any time during this pandemic is not because a Prime Minister or a First Minister or any politician tells you to do so. The reason all of us should do this is to keep ourselves and those we love and the whole country as safe as possible. So I would appeal to everybody, while we're still in this pandemic, not to allow understandable and justified anger at politicians get in the way of doing the right thing for yourself and your loved ones.
Alexander Burnett, to be followed by Marie McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Now, with so many people contracting COVID over the festive period, many will not be able to get their booster for another 4 weeks. And as the First Minister said in a statement, more than 600,000 people over the age of 18 are eligible for a booster but haven't had it yet. And there are hundreds of thousands more who have not yet had a first or second dose. So will the First Minister therefore commit to keeping mass vaccination centres open for the foreseeable future, such as the Scolty Centre in Bankery?
First Minister.
We will keep access to vaccination open and available and accessible. I absolutely give that assurance. It will never be too late to get this vaccination. I'm not going to stand here and say that every single centre that was open and necessary while we were vaccinating large numbers of people on a daily basis will remain open, because as we go through different phases of this vaccination programme, different models of provision will be more appropriate. So a large vaccination centre, when we're dealing with more of a trickle of people rather than a big flood of people, would not be a good or an efficient use of resources. So we will judge this on an ongoing basis, as we have done throughout. I don't pretend on any aspect of handling this virus that we've got everything right all of the time. Manifestly, we have not. But we stand here right now as on first, second, third and booster doses as the most vaccinated part of the UK, which would suggest that the approaches we have taken to this so far have been effective, and we've got a responsibility to make sure they remain so. But on the central question, of course, we will absolutely make sure that anybody now who isn't already vaccinated, who wants to come forward for their vaccination, has the ability to do so.
Marie McNair, to be followed by Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Whilst the support announced by the Scottish Government in recent weeks has been welcomed, particularly given that support is not available to businesses elsewhere in the UK, my office has been contacted by a local independent travel agent who continues to struggle due to COVID. Given the Scottish Government does not have the powers to borrow resources to extend support further to other businesses, what representation has the First Minister made to the UK Government to provide funding for those currently not eligible for financial support?
First Minister.
We have made repeated calls on the UK Government to increase the level of support available during the Omicron wave, either across the UK or, and we've been joined in this call by the Welsh and the Northern Irish Governments, to make available a process whereby our devolved governments can do so. There have been some new money provided, but not nearly as much as I think would have been appropriate, but we continue to ensure that we maximise what we are able to provide from our own resources and get this money to businesses as quickly as possible. As I said in relation to a previous answer, there are some funds that we have made available that we have not yet allocated, and therefore we are further consulting with affected sectors, and this may be relevant to Marie McNair's question, with those sectors about how it can best be targeted.
Paul Sweeney, to be followed by Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I press the First Minister on my constituents who have been affected by the closure of theatres in Glasgow? They've gone a month without wages, and they really need direct assurance from the First Minister that they will be helped. That is a serious financial imposition at this time. So can I ask the First Minister to take direct oversight of this particular issue? Up to 150 workers affected. Can they please get a clear solution from the First Minister? Happy to follow up with the First Minister if necessary. Thank you.
First Minister.
I have oversight of all aspects of the response to COVID. That's my job and in my duty. I understand absolutely how difficult it is for any organisation, whether it's theatres or other businesses that have been impacted by these recent restrictions. That's why we have allocated money and are working to get that money to organisations and therefore to those who need it most as quickly as possible. Of course, I'll ask the Economy Secretary to follow up in more detail with the member, should that be helpful.
Stuart McMillan to be followed by Sharon Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Last week it was announced that a £4 million funding package would be put in place to support unpaid carers. What impact does the First Minister anticipate this will have on the lives of unpaid carers who have faced greatly increased pressures during the pandemic?
First Minister.
Well, lots of people, almost everybody in the country, but particular groups of people have been very severely impacted by this pandemic, but there are few groups who have been impacted more severely than unpaid carers, who already carry a significant burden and have had that burden seriously exacerbated because of the pressures and the strains of dealing with COVID. There is no amount of money that will ever repay unpaid carers for the debt we owe them, but through a number of strands, the supplement to the carers allowance, for example, where we try to do more to help, and this additional money will help to provide some respite for carers and additional support in different ways to help them deal with the burden that they're currently carrying. But we will continue to look for all ways in which we can further support unpaid carers in the period ahead.
Sharon Dowie to be followed by Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. From large-scale events like Edinburgh's Hugmanay to smaller ones like Prestwick's Christmas Market, events organisers have had a tough festive period. This has had a knock-on effect on other businesses, including B&Bs, who have already had a difficult year, and cancelled events have only added to their problems. My question is twofold. How much of the £21 million to support culture and events is now actually in the pockets of recipients? What support has been provided to B&B owners and other providers of short-term accommodation since December 2021, and what plans are there to introduce additional support?
First Minister.
The money that we've made available across different sectors is in the process of flowing to businesses. As I said, I think in response to Paul Sweeney, or it may have been Daniel Johnson's question, we will publish outturn information on each of the strands of business support that will show exactly how much of it has been allocated, and we'll publish that information at the end of January, and we will continue to ensure that we're doing as much as possible to support, whether it's B&Bs or other parts of the hospitality and leisure sectors that have been very, very badly affected by the pandemic generally, but in particular in these past few weeks. But again, I repeat a central point here. The most important thing we can do, well, perhaps not the most important thing, because in the immediate term that is financial assistance, but overall the most important thing we can do is keep COVID under control, which is why I would appeal to everybody across the chamber to understand why a careful, cautious path out of this wave is really important in the wider economic interests as well as the health interests of the country.
And Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it plans to ensure that the inequality gap does not widen as a result of the thousands of people being plunged into debt due to the pandemic, along with soaring energy prices, food costs, and coupled with the cuts to universal credit.
First Minister.
Well, in this government, we're taking a range of actions to try to tackle inequality. The national mission to tackle child poverty, the commitment, for example, of more than £800 million to provide more affordable housing. In the COVID recovery strategy, we set out very specific actions to tackle the inequalities that have been exacerbated by COVID. That includes work to increase financial security for low-income households. This financial year, we're providing more than £7 million to support free debt advice, including funding to meet increased demand over the winter period. We had TV adverts starting this week through our Money Support campaign, making it clear that people don't have to deal with financial problems alone, signposting them to free debt advice services, and that is just some of the support this government is providing. But Evelyn Tweed is absolutely right that all of this is being undermined by the lack of action on the part of the UK government to help with soaring energy costs and wider inflationary pressures. And of course, all of this has been severely undermined
by the completely wrong-headed and cruel decision to remove the £20 a week universal credit uplift. So as we take action, it is incumbent across all of us in this chamber to call on the UK government to live up to their responsibilities to ensure that inequality does not get worse as a result of the pandemic we are living through.
That concludes the First Minister's statement, COVID-19 update. There will be a brief pause before the next statement.